Tonight, we're going to start our study about a third of the way down the page. I believe we may have gone over this once, but I would like to review it just to make sure we know where we are, that we're all on the same page here, and we're all together. Tonight, we're going to watch the fifth step segue into the sixth and seventh step. But let's kind of get ourselves oriented as to where we are. The fifth step, of course, is that step which has the ancient history behind it, the step in which we admit our faults to another human being, as well, of course, as to ourselves and to God. But the key seems to be that admission face-to-face, eyeball-to-eyeball with another person. And as we talked about a couple weeks, looking back into history, we find that this is been an action of immense spiritual significance. And the big book tells us that it is by doing this that we learn the humility, the honesty, and the fearlessness which is necessary in order for us to go forward with the rest of the steps. So we, in the center of the page, or the third of the way down, the second full paragraph, we pocket our pride and go to it. Remember, we talked about this last week, I think, but this one sentence is the whole fifth step. These are the only directions we have. We pocket our pride and go to it. Pocketing our pride, of course, does not mean that we are capable of putting our pride aside. We're going to have God's help with that. What it does mean is that we put it aside for right now. We say, okay, in spite of the fact that these things I'm going to do are seriously disrupting my pride, threatening my pride, threatening my self-image, threatening everything that I've tried to get other people to believe about me, even those things that I have come to believe about myself, which I know deep down inside of me are not true. So I'm going to pocket that, put it aside. Pocket our pride and go to it. Pure action. Just get it on. Illuminating. Illuminating is a word which means exactly what it says. We're shining the bright light, the arc lights, the bright light of day on our defects, upon our full story. Illuminating every twist of character, every dark cranny of the past. Please notice that in the big book, in contradistinction to other literature in the AA library, in the big book, there is no such thing as spending our precious fifth step time talking about all of our wonderful points. Because the good things are not the things that are killing us. It's the bad stuff that's killing us, and it's the bad stuff we have to admit and get rid of with God's help. And so we're going to illuminate every twist of character, every dark cranny of the past. And once we've taken this step, withholding nothing, we are delighted. Now these sentences which follow are part of the promises. And as a matter of fact, as we read this, please notice that what's happening here is that we are rapidly approaching a spiritual awakening. Much of the spiritual awakening which we will experience by the time we reach the 12th step is already kicking in here in the fifth step. That's how powerful this step is. Once we have taken this step with holding nothing, we are delighted. We can look the world in the eye. We're no longer walking around with our heads down. We're no longer hiding. We're no longer dodging people. We're standing up straight. We're taking responsibility, not only for our actions, but we're taking responsibility for ourselves and for the preservation of our spirit, of our soul, which we have sadly neglected all these years. We can be alone at perfect peace and ease. Now, when you do your four-step fears list, one of the things which almost always crops up is the fear of being alone, the fear of being lonely, the fear of being left alone. Even translates itself into the fear of dying alone. Nobody loves me. Everybody hates me. I think I'm going to eat some worms. It's just not true. But we are afraid of it. And so we can now be alone at perfect peace and ease. Why? Because we're no longer having to deal with those things which have been the devils in our consciousness, the devils in our dreams, the things that kept us awake, the things that kept us struggling. And now we have been freed from that whole mess. Our fears fall from us. One of the great promises in the whole big book. Five little words. Our fears fall from us. Why is that such a great promise? Think about it for a second. Fear is our enemy. Fear is the only enemy we have. FDR said the only thing we have to fear is fear itself. He also said, I hate law. My dog Fella hates law. My wife Eleanor hates law. And I hate my wife Eleanor. One of his famous fireside chats. But what he said was true. The only thing we have to fear is fear itself. You know, if we were to categorize the devil and give the devil names, we would have to put fear right at the top of the list. If there is such a thing. I don't claim to know one way or another, but I do know about fear because I have experienced it and I know how deadly it is. And here, what's the promise? Our fears fall from us. Is that not something we want to work for? That we want to put out every effort to get? Remember now, in the fourth and fifth step, we've been given the entire spiritual answer, the remedy to fear. Fear recognized and written down and discussed with another person and turned over to God equals no fear. And we get to use that for the rest of our lives if we choose to do so. We begin to feel the nearness of our Creator. Well now, back in the fourth chapter, what did we read? That we were going to find God deep down inside ourselves. It was only there that He could be found. But that was a promise too, and now it's coming true. We may have had certain spiritual beliefs, but now we begin to have a spiritual experience. Spiritual experience is a buzzword here for spiritual awakening. Bill did not use the term spiritual awakening when he wrote the big book. That was added by the editorial board when they looked over his manuscript. He used the word spiritual experience to mean that entire collection of spiritual experiences which add up to the spiritual experience, that one thing which turns the corner for us and which creates in us an entire psychic change so that we go from a place of rebellion and defiance to a place of surrender and obedience, which is where we must be. The feeling that the drink problem has disappeared will often come strongly. And that will be solidified, of course, by the time we reach the 10th step. Remember that there we are going to experience that the problem has been removed. It does not exist for us. And this has happened automatically because we worked the steps. Now this takes us right back to chapter 4 again, doesn't it? In chapter 4 we were promised that this book is all about finding a power greater than ourselves which will solve our problem. And here in the fifth step already we find our problem being solved. We feel we're on the broad highway walking hand in hand with the spirit of the universe. This is the beginning of that wonderful revelation which comes to us by the time we have reached the 10th step. That we have in fact become God conscious. Conscious of the God within. Conscious of our place in God's universe. Conscious of the fact that the sunlight of the Spirit is now full upon us. And so if you're contemplating a fifth step and hanging back, read what's going to happen and go to it. It's wonderful. Now not everybody gets all of these things all at once. Some don't, but many do, and they're all available to each of us. Then we read last week, I think we did, but if not, we're going to go to the last paragraph on page 75. Now, this paragraph is the paragraph which segues into the sixth and seventh steps. Let's keep in mind that all of our steps work together. Each of our steps is preparatory for those which will follow. And each of our steps is dependent upon those which came before, because they all fit together in a wonderful panoply, a continuum of spiritual growth. So here we have the only time limit in the big book that is expressed in hours, seconds, minutes, or days, or in any other time frame. Returning home, we find a place where we can be quiet for an hour. Now keep in mind that the big book here is talking about that day when we have done our fifth step. This is the same day. We return home, we get by ourselves where we can be quiet for an hour, carefully reviewing what we've done. We thank God from the bottom of our heart that we know Him better. Taking this book down from our shelf, we turn to the page which contains the 12 steps. Carefully reading the first five proposals, we ask if we have omitted anything. For we are building an arch through which we shall walk a free man at last. See what we're doing here? We're going back to make sure that everything we've done up through the fifth step has been true and correct, that it has been done to the very best of our ability, but more important, that we haven't left anything out. That to the best of our knowledge, we've been true to ourselves. We've been honest with ourselves. Because remember what we learned right there in the beginning of chapter 5, and we read it at every meeting, or most meetings, that those who do not recover are those people who cannot or will not completely give themselves to this simple program. Usually, men and women who are constitutionally incapable of being honest with themselves. So this whole question of honesty really boils down to self-honesty. It boils down to the absence of self-delusion, that terrible part of self which has been the cause of so many of our difficulties. And so as we're looking back, our job here is to make sure that we are not fooling ourselves, we're not lying to ourselves, and we're not lying to another human being, we're not lying to God. That in fact we have done a thorough job of illuminating every twist of character, every dark cranny of the past. Furthermore, we need to see as we do this that we have very successfully identified our defects of character, and that we have admitted these defects, and that we have identified the people we've harmed, and that we have admitted the harm that we've done. Because we're not only setting out on a course here now to be relieved of our defects, but we're setting out on a course to be relieved of our guilt and remorse and shame, which is the result of the things we've done that was harmful to other people. And so we're going to carefully consider this. Did I recognize the danger of my defects, the cancerousness of my defects, the fact that these are rotting my soul and have stood in the way of my relationship with my God, that these things are blocking me from the sunlight of the Spirit? Did I also clearly understand and accept the fact that I can't get rid of these things myself? That I need God's help to be free of them? Did I make a determination that there wasn't anything there that I was even not only willing to hang on to, but was anything there I didn't actively want to be freed from, these things that are killing me? And looking back now in this hour, I can see that, yes, I want to be freed from all these defects which I identified in my fourth step and I have admitted in my fifth step. And I'm not holding anything back, because I found out just how deadly they can be. And so now we have reviewed in this hour and we've come to these conclusions. And then we are, because we are building an arch through which we shall walk a free man at last. Remember the arch we talked about, the big book talked about back in the third step, that the decision of the third step, the decision to turn our life and will over the care of God, was the keystone to this new and triumphant arch through which we would walk at last to freedom. The keystone, that stone which holds both sides of the arch up. And now we've come to that place where we see that we're building this arch and that we must be very careful as to how we're doing this. And this is what the big book says about this. Is our work solid so far? Have we built this arch solidly so far? Are the stones properly in place, or are some of them cattywampus? Have we skimped on the cement put into the foundation? Have we tried to make mortar without sand? Mortar without sand will not hold anything. It simply crumbles. So in order for us to have mortar, we have to have the sand in there. We have to have carefully concocted our mortar so that when we place the stones in place, they're going to stay. This is what we look at in that hour. And this is the hour following, immediately following our fifth step. Because it is going to move us directly into the sixth step. Turn the page, page 76. Now there's a whole lot of confusion about the sixth step. A whole lot of confusion. There are New Age AA theories out there that are proliferated like a bunch of rabbits in season. There are all kinds of psychological and psychiatric and psychobabble theories about the sixth step. There is a misreading of the sixth step in almost every department. And there are people, and I don't want to be deliberately insulting to anybody, believe me, but we're reading it together here so that we can see precisely what the big book says. I guess it boils down to this. Either the big book is right or the other literature is right. We can't have it both ways. There is no way to reconcile the two. So it's important for us to take a look at what the big book says. And in light of that, please let us remember that this big book was written in 1939. And since that time, people all over the world, using what was written, translated into 28 foreign languages and being used in 170 different countries, millions of people utilizing what we're reading right now tonight have recovered from a seemingly hopeless state of mind and body. Why in the world would we want to experiment around knowing that that's true? Why would we take the risk with our own lives, our own spirit, when we know that what we're looking at here is what has been the formula for recovery for millions? What in the world more do we need to know than that? Unfortunately, there's a lot of confusion about this. And the sixth step has been made into something which it is not and never could be. Let's look back for a second at how this came to be written. Keep in mind that at the time the big book was being written, at the time that Bill Wilson sat down or lay down in his bed to write out what he knew were going to be the steps, and he did not know how many there were going to be. All he had to work with were the six steps of the Oxford group. And the fact that the people for 3 years in AA had been through trial and error developing other steps, or at least what could be identified as steps. But Bill was of a mind that he had to write something which could not be mistaken in any way, because he knew alcoholics for what we are. That we would take, twist, and pervert anything we could get our hands on. That we would be very happy to find an easier, softer way any time we could do it. That we would be glad to hold our meetings outside with the half measures group. And so he said, and he wrote about this later, it is absolutely essential, I believe, that we write down something which was ironclad, which could not be mistaken, which could not be twisted or perverted by anybody. We want to make it as clear as possible exactly what needed to be done. Now, it's important to remember that when Bill wrote the 12 steps, he was writing of the experience of those who came before us who helped to write the big book. Go back to the forward to the first edition, we find that they're telling us that to show other alcoholics precisely how we have recovered is the main purpose of this volume. And Bill wrote this from the standpoint, from the viewpoint of the experience of those with whom he had contact those 3 years. People just like Bill who had recovered from a seemingly hopeless state of mind and body. The idea here was simple. They knew that it worked for them. They truly believed that if the people who followed them would do what they did, those people too would recover. And this is why they wrote the book the way they did. So when you read the steps, you're reading of the experience of those who came before, those who helped to write the book. You're not reading of some kind of a philosophical system dreamed up by somebody trying to get their master's degree in a psych course. This is the real life experience of those who lived it. And so when we read the steps and we begin to follow the directions, we're following the directions which were pioneered for us by those 100. Now when we look at the sixth step, we must first put the word we in front, because we is in front of every one of our, every one of the steps, it's an implied we. Bill didn't feel the necessity for writing it down more than once. We, the first 100, were entirely ready to have God remove all these defects of character. Now, Bill wrote this because he felt the necessity to have a bridge between the fifth step and the seventh step. He wanted us to have a step which, in case something had gone awry in our fourth and fifth steps, we would know what to do. He was not willing to trust that because it would, in most people, the desire, the readiness, the willingness to be freed from defects would have matured and materialized in the fifth step. He wasn't willing to trust that. He wanted to make sure that we understood that if that had not happened, there was a way to correct the situation. This step is the bridge between 5 and 7. And it states a fact. And it is stated in the past participle. Nowhere does it say I made myself ready. Nowhere does it say I took 9 months of putting quarters in parking meters or driving the speed limit or brushing my teeth with my left hand. Or any of the other stuff. Nowhere does it even intimate that this is the step which separates the men from the boys. That's utter errant foolishness. Because it is simply the interim step acknowledging a fact that because we did the fourth and fifth step correctly, we have been granted the great gift of readiness and willingness to let God now take away all these things that have been killing us and blocking us off from Him. And why wouldn't we? We'd be crazy not to. And so, we need to be extremely careful not to fall into the trap. And this trap is a deadly one because it creates an enormous inconsistency between the facts and the instructions. If we are instructed to work on our defects on the one hand and instructed on the other hand that we can't work on them because we're powerless over them, what kind of confusion is that going to create in the mind of a newcomer? Maybe that's too logical. We have learned in our fourth and fifth steps, and even back in our third step, that we are powerless over the defects of character identified in our fourth step: resentment, dishonesty, selfishness, and fear. We cannot get rid of them ourselves. And then to come along and say, oh, but now you get to work on these things. And you must ask yourself, how do I do that? If I'm powerless, if the only hope I have of being free from these is a loving God, and that's been provided for me in the sixth and seventh step, what am I doing here? So I guess it's important for us to ask these questions. At the top of page 76 is the sixth step. Let's read it and consider what it's saying. The first sentence, if we can answer to our satisfaction, refers back to the paragraph on page 75, which we studied a little earlier this evening. Carefully reading the first five proposals, we ask if we've omitted anything. And now on page 76, if we can answer to our satisfaction, then we look at step six. We have emphasized willingness as being indispensable. Are we now ready to let God remove from us all the things which we have admitted are objectionable? Those admissions were made in the fifth step, weren't they? And we wrote them out in the fourth step. And now are we willing and ready to have God remove all those things, all those defects of character? Can he take them all, every one? Do we see any kind of equivocation there? Do we see any sort of weasel words there? Is there any out clause there? No. We're not talking about something which is optional. We're not talking here about something which we can play games with. In spite of what we may find in other literature, the fact is that all of these defects of character stand in the way of our recovery because they stand between us and God. Remember back there, before we start our fourth step, we learned that it was necessary for us to face and to be rid of all the things in ourselves which have been blocking us from God. And that all means all. It doesn't mean some. It doesn't mean we can piddle around with some of these things and say, oh, well, I don't want to get rid of that right now. I think I'll hang on to that for a while and just suffer with it. Just as long as I never say never, I'm going to be okay. Balderdash. We're not okay as long as we have anything which is blocking us from God. How can we be okay if we're blocked from the sunlight of the Spirit? How do we plan to go through a process of recovery when we do not let God in because we wish to hang on to some things which we know are killing us? Crazy. It's idiocy. It absolutely makes no sense whatsoever. So let's read. When we read the big book, we hear the truth. Are we now ready to let God remove from us all the things which we have admitted are objectionable? Can he now take them all, every one? What part of all don't we understand? Now, we talked about this earlier. This sixth step is designed specifically to do two things. One, to state the obvious being that as a result of our fourth and fifth step, we have become ready to have God take these things that are killing us, that are blocking us from him. But in the off chance that we are not ready and willing, it is also designed to give us a solution to that problem, which is stated in the next sentence. If we still cling to something we will not let go, we ask God to help us be willing. The sole and single solution to the lack of readiness or willingness to let go of our defects of character is to pray for the willingness. The same type of prayer that we started using all the way back in the second step, asking God to make us willing to believe that he may just exist. The same willingness that we prayed for in the third step, and again in the fourth step. And now we find it in the sixth step. And we'll find it again in the eighth step. We pray for the willingness until it comes. We do not move on to the seventh step until we have asked God to make us willing to be freed from everything that we have determined is blocking us from Him. It's that simple. And when we back away from that, if we read other literature which tells us an entirely different story, then we find ourselves in this position. We found out what the problem is. We've admitted what the problem is, but we have not completed the solution to being free from these problems, because we have allowed self to intrude again. We're now making decisions based on self. We're now reneging on our third step decision, and we put ourselves in mortal jeopardy. Because the fact is that we have no hope of survival except with the intervention of a loving God. Now, you may find that there are other programs out there that speak differently. In here, that's what we have, and that's what works. And we know it works, because it's worked for millions. And so when we look at the sixth step, remember that it teaches us two things. One, that we are to set ourselves free with God's help from everything that blocks us from Him, and that we have received this as a great gift. And if so, for some reason, we're not willing, we ask for the willingness till it comes. That's what the sixth step means. And when that willingness has manifested itself and we can say clearly that we're entirely ready to have God take all these defects of character, then we are ready for the seventh step, which follows immediately. And please notice that the sixth and seventh step are done on the same day we do our fifth step. You know, I just have to tell you that it's really tough having to live your life with people around you sticking pins in you all the time. I think I'm gonna... You don't feel sorry for me?
Call your sponsor.
Say, Bud, if you're listening, my sponsor died about 4 years ago, and he was 94 or 95 at the time, 54 years sober. Still sponsoring five people and going to five meetings a week. We miss him. That's why he was 94 and still sober and 54 years later, because he never stopped. This is the kind of thing that I hope everybody who comes to the Stairway Group will get firmly in mind. This is a lifetime program. What we learn now is something that's going to stay with us, and we're going to keep doing it, and when we do that, our whole life changes. We get to have that whole brand new life that we've always wanted.
Great. Thank you, Jim.
Yes.
And wonderful celebrants. Lennon really nicely said tonight. And I'm just really happy that Larry realized he better do his fifth step right, because if you don't do your fifth step right, then the 33rd year, you'll definitely drink.
A 33rd year is the hardest, too, though.
It's a danger year.
Danger year.
Woo, just in time. But anyway, here in South Florida, we have the CHIP system here at the Stairways Group. The CHIPs are red, white, and blue, symbolizing freedom from bondage of self through this program. And it all starts with the white CHIP, the International Sign of Surrender. Not only is this CHIP white.
What color?
It's white.
It's white.
It's white. Not only, but it's round. Like, oh, like the number 3 you're supposed to have. Oh. And like the O in hope, where the HPE stands for higher power is everything. And if you're like Rob, you got this in your pocket for at least 7 years. Would anyone like to start this way of life and surrender and pick up a white chip? It's all white to pick up a white chip tonight.
It's all white. Come on up.
Ah, come on. He told me to say it. White chip? Nope. Okay, and after 3 months, there is a red chip. And it means that if by 3 months, you better have read the big book. Has anyone earned a red chip this evening? 3 months. Ow! Yeah.
Marilyn, you got to ask him if anybody's read the big book.
Stan, did you read the big book by now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. That is Stan the man. Okay. Next, after 6 months, you've earned a blue chip. Has anyone earned a blue chip this evening? Yes! The right place to say that. That is Jose, and Jose is looking for a sponsor. Stand up again, Jose. See where he is? Okay, next, we have the silver thing. I call it a thing because Jim actually melted down Budweiser cans in his laboratory, where Igor helped him. And formed these little round chips, and instead of Bud, there is now Bill and Bob on the Bud can. So, has anyone earned a 9-month
Bill and Bob chip?
Bill and Bob chip. All right.
Well, thank you, Igor. That was nice.
Igor, what home? Okay. Then after a year, we celebrate. Did everybody enjoy the whoopee party this evening? Yes?
Whoopee!
Okay, we're going to have another one, March 29th, right here at the 101 Club, where the whoopee party was originated. Just look on page 101, that's other guy's name. But anyway, who is celebrating in the month of March? March celebrants. Oh, no. You don't get no cake unless you're celebrating. All right, well, probably somebody will by the end, by March 29th, we'll find somebody to make a cake for. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Marilyn. Marilyn, in that little fashion. I want to remind you all that immediately following this meeting, at precisely at 9:15, we will convene in the clean room back there, and we're going to be doing language for heart meeting. I invite all of you to join us. We have a lot of fun, it's a good meeting, and everybody gets a chance to share. You have to listen to me a little bit, but it's not nearly as long-winded as this meeting, so maybe that'll give you a heart. Also, do we have any announcements tonight for the good of AA? Any commercial announcements? That is to say, forming baseball teams, bowling teams, any kind of whoopee parties. So yes?
Yeah, alcoholic. I just want to point out the flyer on the wall over there for the Duster Mike's party.
For the what?
Duster Mike.
Crawfish.
Big crawfish party. Starts at 12 o'clock, meeting at 10 o'clock at night. Music. All the food you can eat free.
Ooh.
Oh! When is that?
Alcohol's no free stuff.
Yay!
Okay. See the poster on the wall with the free food. You might have to listen to somebody spout it off like me. Well, we feed you. We have bread cake and cookies. Okay. Any other announcements? Thank you all so very much. Let's close the meeting, and we'll see your people from the clean room join us. Get our newest member in here.
Yeah.
In the stairway group, we start them off young. Let this circle represent the unity of our fellowship. Have a moment of silence for those who are still suffering. And then we'll say the Lord's Prayer together. Please remember, in the stairway group, we don't say anything after we have said amen. Thank you. Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
you all so much. See you next week. I'm going to break off.